Romans chapter 12, it says there toward the end of the chapter, and I'm going to turn there and give you the specific verse, but it says, vengeance is mine. And so that's verse 19. Avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. And how he repays might be different from how you might do it in the flesh. I mean, Saul of Tarsus was hurting the Christians. He was persecuting the Christians. In fact, when he had that experience on the road to Damascus and Jesus said, why do you persecute me? He said, who are you, Lord? You know, how am I persecuting you? And so he's persecuting the Christians, and yet how God responded to that was put him in the ministry and give him a strong anointing. So how God responds might be different from how we might, but God will repay. He says, vengeance is mine. And there in that verse also, verse 19, it says, give place unto wrath. That is, have a place for it where you put up with it. Now, again, he's not suggesting, as in Matthew 5, that you just be a doormat, let people walk all over you. But what he's saying is don't respond with the flesh. All right, they're forcing you to go a mile. Well, don't get mad about that. Why don't you go 2 miles? That'll calm you down, and that'll calm them down too. There's also scripture that says agree with your adversary while you're in the way. There are testimonies. If somebody sees that, it'll be a testimony to them. Because that'll be a surprise. When Jesus was reviled, he reviled not again. It wasn't because he was a doormat. It's because he had the strength to control it. Meekness really is a control. It's a strength. So they're taking my coat. Well, instead of getting angry about that, why don't you? That doesn't mean that you're just a doormat and you let people walk all over you. That means they're not going to steal your joy. You're not going to allow it. God's your source anyway. You can go to God and get a coat and a cloak too. I'm not going to let them steal my joy. I'm not going to let them steal my peace. They take my coat, I'll give them my cloak too. That'll calm them down, and that'll calm me down, and it'll put my spirit in the right place. So I have a place in me for that wrath to where I take it. And see, that's in line. Well, let's continue with Romans 12 before we leave. If your enemy hungers, feed him. If he's thirsty, let him give him something to drink. For in so doing, you heap coals of fire on his head. And this really is going back to the Old Testament practice, and they understood it. You're going from one campsite to the other campsite, and they're carrying the fire. The coals may be wrapped up in an urn on their head. And that's their sustenance. That's important to them. That's a blessing to them. When they get to the next camp place, they're going to need that. And the coals, maybe if it's during the cool of the day, that's keeping them warm. But it's their sustenance when they get to where they're going. That's their campfire. They're going to use that to heat their food and, you know, cook their food and heat themselves. And so the coals of fire on their head is a blessing. It's like we may describe it as hot love. You're showing love and you're blessing them with these coals of fire on their head. See, it's not destructive. It's not hurtful. It's a blessing. You're giving them a blessing. Well, your enemy is hungry. You're going to feed him. Your enemy is thirsty. You're going to give him a drink. And you're putting those blessings, just like that, those coals of fire that they might carry in that urn wrapped up as insulation from place to place. So don't be not overcome of evil. When the Bible says pray for your enemies, it'll do you more good than it will them. Sometimes it may not affect them because they'll have to respond, and very often people don't respond, but it'll keep your love walk in check because they're hurting you and you're praying. Somebody said, I'm praying for them. I'm praying God would destroy them. That's what I'm doing. I'm praying for them. I'm praying all right. I'm praying God would destroy them. No, that's not what he meant. He meant pray blessing upon them. They're hurting you, then pray blessing upon them. That'll do you more good than it will them. So when it says turn the cheek, it means let your spirit make the right decision of self-control rather than retaliate by they hit me, I'm going to hit them. They hit my face, I'm going to hit their face. They punched me in the nose, I'm going to punch them in the nose. In fact, in Matthew 5, he's saying, you've heard an eye for an eye. Well, let me tell you what. Here's what I'm saying, that if they hit you, then there's a place where you take it. You don't, that doesn't mean, again, he's not saying being a punching bag. He's saying don't retaliate after the flesh and after the emotion and after the anger. We said some of these things Sunday night in the message that we titled Developing Christian Character. And I referred to a scripture in Proverbs 16, verse 32, because anger is the part of the emotion. And in Proverbs 16:32, when it says, he that's slow to anger is better than the mighty, and he that ruleth his spirit than he that taketh a city. Spirit there means emotion or temper, or I'm just really upset. I'm just mad. They hit me and I got mad. I just lost my temper. Well, this says that if you're slow to anger, then you're better than the people that are the strong ones in the gyms, you know, that are having the competition of being bodybuilders. And that doesn't mean that that's wrong. Paul wrote, bodily exercise profiteth. Now, he said it profits little, but he said it did profit. But godliness with contentment is great gain. And if you'll be slow to anger, you're stronger than they are. Well, they look real strong and mighty. Well, if you're slow to anger, in God's eyes, you're stronger than they are. And if you can control your anger, your temper, spirit there means emotion, then you're stronger than the one that can take a city. And a similar scripture is in Proverbs 25 and verse 28. And this is the opposite side. If you have no control, no rule over your own emotion, you know, people get upset. That just made me upset. Well, if you don't have any control over being upset, then you're like a city broken down and without walls. And in that day, of course, what he meant was the city that didn't have walls, didn't have protection, and the enemy could come take that city. Well, now he's saying, if you don't have any control over your emotion, over your anger, over your temper, over acting on being upset, then you don't have protection against the enemy. Who's our enemy? The Bible says Satan's our enemy, and the shield of faith quenches the fiery darts, but faith works by love. And Jesus didn't say just love the people you like. He didn't say just love the people that are treating you good. He said love your enemy. And so if I'm not walking in love, then my shield's not going to be effective and do its job. And so it reminds me also of scripture that we also shared Sunday night in 1 Corinthians 13. And in the Amplified Bible, these verses 4 through 8 are really powerful. I mean, other translations are wonderful, but I really enjoy the Amplified Bible of 1 Corinthians 13 and 4 through 8, talking about love. And so let me turn around and look and read it to you. Love endures long. Somebody said, that's me. I've endured a long time. But it also says, while you're enduring long, you're patient and kind. And so that's a quality. That's a qualification. Love will endure, and while it's enduring, love will be patient and kind. Love is never envious, nor boils over with jealousy, is not boastful or vainglorious, does not display itself haughtily. Display means other people see it. Your own display. Isn't that what display means? Your own display. Well, love will never display itself haughtily. It's not conceited. It's not arrogant. Not inflated with pride, is not rude, unmannerly, does not act unbecomingly. Love, God's love in us, does not insist on its own rights. That's a big one. People say, well, I know my rights. Again, this isn't saying that you let people abuse the things that are of God. If God's called you to a work and somebody comes in and says, we're just going to stop you. It's like where they said, we are to obey God instead of man. We're going to obey God. That doesn't mean in a church service where God is using someone in the leadership of the meeting and someone else wants to take over. You know, I hear God too. There is scripture that says if something's revealed, let the first hold his peace and we're to yield. But that doesn't mean let them take over when they don't have the Spirit of God. They just have their own agenda where I'm just going to let people take over. No, you know that God's leading you to direct the service, and you need to keep that charge. This is referring to the difference between the spirit and the flesh. where the flesh wants to recoil at someone coming in and saying, this is what we want you to do. No, I know my rights. The on the job, they tell you to do this. No, I don't have to take that. I don't have to take this job. I don't have to take that. I don't have to take that from anybody. Well, is that your flesh? Are you upset? Is that anger? Is that emotion? Because love does not insist on its own rights. Love does not insist on its own way. Love is not self-seeking. It is not touchy. That is, it doesn't respond by the emotion of being offended or bothered or upset. It's not fretful. It's not resentful. Now, I know sometimes I get frustrated, but I don't want to ever say anything that's because of it or act on it because of it. I may do something or say something when I'm frustrated, but I never want to do it or say it because I'm frustrated. Everything that I say and do, I want to make sure that it's in line with the Word of God and the Spirit of God, and then I need to calm down and not have the frustration. I think at times Jesus must have been exasperated or frustrated because he one time said, "Faithless and perverse generation, how long am I going to be with you? How long am I going to suffer you or to put up with this?" There's a time in Luke chapter 9 where John came and said, "We saw somebody casting out devils. They don't walk with us. We forbade them." Jesus said, "Don't forbid them. If they're not against us, they're for us." And then a little bit later in Luke chapter 9, Peter and John came to him because they weren't accepting Jesus where they were going. And Peter and John said, "Do you want us to call fire down from heaven the way Elijah did? We've got scripture now." And see, when people justify it with scripture, "I've got scripture for this." Well, Jesus said to Peter and John there in Luke chapter 9, "You don't know what spirit you have. You may have the scripture, but you've got the wrong motive behind the scripture. You may have the scripture, but it's your flesh that's wanting to use that scripture for your own vindication or your own personal agenda." And I don't know if he's a little exasperated. How long am I going to have to keep telling you this? You don't know what spirit you have. Amen. So you may be, they're not accepting you. Well, that maybe bothers me, but I'm not going to respond. I mean, I observe it. They're not accepting your ministry, Jesus. We want to call fire down from heaven. Well, let's get them. And Jesus said, "You don't know what spirit you have. I didn't come to destroy people. I didn't come to destroy them. They're not accepting me, but I didn't come to destroy them." And I don't know if he was a little frustrated with them or not, but he's still saying, this is what is right. And love is not going to be touchy or fretful or resentful. And this next phrase is a really good one. It takes no account of the evil done to it. It pays no attention to a suffered wrong. Well, look how they've treated me. I've got a tract, a pamphlet that I've written. How do you treat people? I believe that's important. How do you treat people? Anybody can treat somebody nice when they're treating you nice. Anybody can treat somebody well when they're treating you well. It's important how you treat people when you're being mistreated. And again, it's not to say you're to be a doormat and you're to be a punching bag and you're just to let people walk all over you and just take advantage of you in that sense. But sometimes I have let people, they think they're taking advantage of me, but I'm allowing it. And I maybe have a different reason for allowing it on my end because I've given place to the wrath. And I'm going to, vengeance is mine, the Lord said. And he'll take care of it, and he'll take care of me too. Well, they took your coat. Yeah, I'm giving them my cloak too. Amen. And so I'm not taking an account. If I'm going to walk in love, I'm going to pay no attention to what they did to me. I'm going to pay no attention to it, what they did to me. And I remember some scriptures that we went over Sunday night in Ephesians chapter 4. Paul said, put on the new man. He said, first of all, he said, put off the old man. It's corrupt according to the deceitful lust and deeds. And then he said, put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. And he's telling you to take what's on the inside, the new man, and put it on. That is, walk as you would walk in the light of the life, to where people can see what you're wearing. It's an outward manifestation. They see it because you've put it on. You've put on the new man so people can see what you've put on. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 22 says, put off the former conversation. That means lifestyle. The old man, corrupt according to the deceitful lust. Be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Put on the new man after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. And then it goes on further, in case you hadn't got it. Now, this isn't something that's already happened. This is something he's telling you to do. Put away lying. Stop lying. Let's every man speak truth with his neighbor. We're members one of another. Be ye angry and sin not. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath. Don't give place to the devil. Now, isn't that what it means? That if you don't rule your spirit, then you're like a city without walls. You're broken down. And that means there's no protection. You're like a city that's broken down without walls. If you don't have any control over your emotion, over your flesh, over your temper. So he says, don't give place to the devil. Isn't that what it meant in Romans chapter 12? Give place unto wrath. If you give place unto the wrath, that means you don't respond to it. You don't act on it. You've got a place for it. You absorb it. Instead of retaliating and responding when Jesus was reviled, he reviled not again. You respond differently. Instead of after the flesh, you respond after the spirit. Because if you respond after the flesh, you're giving place to the devil. And then the devil can come in he brings problems. And the shield of faith doesn't quench them. Well, I'm just believing God. How many people do I know that they are saying the right thing, but if you look at their lifestyle, they don't have the shield up there? Well, I'm just believing that this is going to leave me. I just command it to go. The shield of faith quenches the fiery darts. Well, not your faith, because your faith isn't working. Faith works by love, and your love walk isn't right. And the shield's not working. It's got too many holes in it, or it's not held up. I've got to do some things about my love walk. Can somebody say amen? Let him that stole steal no more. Rather, let him labor, working with his hands, the thing which is good, that he may have to give to him that needeth. That'll stop the moochers going from place to place trying to get everything they can. He's saying, stop doing that. Why don't you go to work, you old lazy thing, you? So you can have to give. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth. That's a good one to dwell on. Make sure what you're saying is good to the use of edifying. And that's when you're talking about the people that have hurt you. That's when you're talking about the people that are acting like your enemies. That's when you're talking about the people that have come against you. That's when you're talking about the people that have slapped you and stole your coat and forced you to walk a mile. Well, you don't know what they did to me, Brother Tony. Well, you keep talking about it, and they're going to keep doing it to you. Because you keep letting that fester. I mean, people get on the phone with me and they want to talk to me about what's happening in their lives. Well, I know godly counsel is important, but they go on and on and on. They get into that vein. They just get into that flow. And I think they think I'm a trash heap. They're going to dump their garbage on me. Well, at some point I want to get them to stop that, because those aren't words of grace. It's not ministering grace to me or to you. I know godly counsel is important, and I listen to a degree, and then I want to help. But part of the help is to get them to see it and stop. They've got to take control over their tongue. We're going to look at that again in a moment. But the corrupt communication is involving the tongue, what's coming out of your mouth, and you've got to stop saying those things, because verse 30 says you're grieving the Holy Spirit. Well, I'm giving place to the devil. My protection's down. He can now come, and the fiery darts come, and the shield of faith isn't working, and I'm grieving the Holy Spirit, and he's my help. Vengeance is his, but I'm grieving him if I'm trying to take charge, and I'm retaliating, and I'm talking about, well, here's what they did to me. And it's venom dripping from your lips. Some things ought to be discussed in the spirit of godly counsel. I told one person this one time, a husband and a wife, pastor, they were wanting to discuss some things with me. Well, what do you think about this, Brother Tony? And I said to them, some things should be discussed in the spirit of godly counsel, but you shouldn't have venom dripping from your lips while you do. Well, they didn't like that. They didn't like that. And they never invited me back to speak for them either. That was it for me. but it's true. And so, let all bitterness, verse 31, let all bitterness, how much? All bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice, and be ye kind one to another, especially to those that you like. Be kind one to another, especially to those that treat you good. Be kind one to another, especially to the people that are just lovely and they love you and you love them. No, it doesn't say that, doesn't mean that, because other scripture says for your enemies to pray for them, and this would include them. Tenderhearted, forgiving. Well, why do you need to forgive somebody that's never mistreated you? Why would you need to forgive somebody that's always been nice to you, never done anything wrong against you? Why would you ever need to forgive somebody that they've just been lovely all their time, all their lives, every opportunity? No, this is somebody that's done something against you. Well, forgive them, even as God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven you. Verse 1 of chapter 5 goes on with the thought, be therefore followers or imitators of God as dear children, and walk in love. Walk in love. Walk in love. Well, we just read some things about love. That means then to do it. Walk in love. In Galatians chapter 5, and we looked at this also Sunday night, in developing Christian character, and maybe this is developing Christian character part 2. But Galatians chapter 5 talks about the fruit of the Spirit, talks about the works of the flesh. That also could be the fruit of the flesh or the works of the Spirit, because they're contrasted one to the other. And so the flesh has desires, the Spirit has desires. Or that is, the flesh has attributes, characteristics. The Spirit has attributes and characteristics. Well, the fruit of the Spirit, there's 9. And people get caught up on that. They say, well, you mean fruits. There's only one fruit, but this says fruit, not fruits. I've had more than one person tell me there's only one fruit. It's love. Everything else comes from love. And the reason they say that is because it says fruit. And I thought to myself, I don't always say it out loud in response, but I thought, well, in your kitchen, you might have a fruit bowl, and there's an apple and an orange and a tangerine and a banana, and you don't say that's a fruits bowl. And you might have a fruit basket. You don't say it's a fruits basket, because I've got more than one in there. I've got apples and oranges and tangerines and grapes and bananas. So that's a fruits basket. So the fruit of the Spirit, there's 9. And these are attributes of Christian character. Only inside of every person, every child of God, every born-again person, every Christian. We already have all of these. We have already have all of these. That's what he meant in Ephesians 4, to put this on. And put off the old man, because of the works of the flesh. There's 17 of them. You can look at the works of the flesh in verse 19. There's 17 of those. And Paul said in Ephesians 4, put those off. That is, don't respond to them. Don't yield to them. These are things that the flesh will want to do. Your flesh hasn't been redeemed yet. Romans chapter 8 says we're desiring, we're groaning within ourselves to know the redemption of the body. The body hasn't been redeemed. When you're born again, it's your spirit that's born again. Your flesh didn't get redeemed. We still have the flesh to contend with. I don't have a dual nature. I have one nature. My nature is of God, but I'm in this earthly house or this earthly tabernacle that has not been redeemed. Romans chapter 8 says that we're groaning within ourselves to know the redemption of the body. The body hasn't been redeemed. In 1 Corinthians 9:27, Paul said, I keep under my body. 1 Corinthians 9:27. Paul said, I keep under my body. What does that mean? I control my body. And if I don't do it, even though I'll preach, I'll be found a castaway. Now you repent and ask for forgiveness. God forgives you and cleanses you, but sometimes people won't. They'll still cast you away. Can somebody say amen? So, Paul said, I keep under my body. If he needed to, so do I. So do you. So the flesh has desires. Flesh hasn't been redeemed. I have to control the flesh. Amen. And then on the inside of every child of God, that includes me, that includes you, there are these attributes, this nature, this character, these characteristics that I can put on. Ephesians 4 said, put on the new man. That means love. That's God's love in us, but it's not God's love toward us. It's His love in us so we can have love toward others. It is God's love. It is God's love, but it's His love not toward me, but His love in me so I can have love toward others. It's my Christian character. I'm going over some of the same things we did Sunday night. But Jesus in John 13:34 said, a new commandment I give, that you love one another as I've loved you. What's new about that is loving as He loves. In the Old Testament, it said, love your neighbor as you love yourself. But in the New Testament, when the Spirit of God and the love of Christ comes inside, then you can love as God loves. The love of God constraineth us. He shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost His love. The love of God is in us by the Holy Ghost. Jesus said they'll know you that you're my disciples because you love. The Bible says we know we've passed from death unto life because we love. And so the love of God has come inside of us. It's not His love toward us. It's His love in us so we can have love toward others. So it's I tapping into the love of God and I walk in love. Well, if that's true of love, and it is, what about joy? James said, count it all joy. So I tap into the joy. I choose to have joy. It's my choice. Emotions come to all of us. Circumstances come to all of us. But the person that is ruled by emotion is going to be up and down, up and down, up and down, like a roller coaster. The person that is constant with the fruit of the Spirit will be the same. You won't be able to tell what circumstance they're in by watching what they do and listening to what they say. You won't be able to tell. They'll be the same. They'll be the same. Constant and consistent because they're the love of God, the love of Christ is constraining them. The fruit of the Spirit's controlling them, or they're allowing it to be controlled. They're keeping their body. They're having dominion. Paul said, I keep under my body. That is, my body wants to do this, I won't let it. My body wants to talk about them, I won't let it. My body wants to gossip, I won't let it. My body wants to be a busybody. My flesh wants to get involved and know their business. A business body, a busy body. Love won't do that. The fruit of the Spirit won't do that. Can somebody say amen? And so if we're going to walk in the fruit of the Spirit, we'll be the same all the time. And you can look at somebody walking in the fruit of the Spirit and you won't be able to tell whether they're having a hard place, a test, and a trial or not. Because they're just the same. They're counted at all joy. They're letting peace rule in their hearts. Jesus said, I'm giving you peace. Not as the world gives. What kind of peace does the world give? Emotion. Circumstances. When everything's going good. Boy, I really am at peace today. And then something comes along and they lose their peace because it's based on circumstances. But Jesus said, I'm giving you another kind of peace. Not that kind of peace, but the peace that's in you. And if you'll respond to that peace, you'll have peace all the time. And you won't be able to tell looking at that person whether they're having a test or a trial or a bad day or circumstance. Amen. Ride out the storm. The fruit of the Spirit will be in dominion if you'll allow it. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness. Long-suffering is patience. You have patience. Is this God's patience? Well, it's His nature in you, but you yield. James said, let patience have her perfect work. That's your decision. You make the choice whether you let patience work or not. I have patience, but I make the choice whether I let patience work or not. I have patience. Now, tests and trials will develop. It gives you faith, or rather patience, in that it develops it. Fruit does ripen. Fruit does grow. Fruit does mature. And patience, long-suffering, is one of the fruit. It'll ripen. It'll mature. It'll grow. And tests and trials help do that. But you better already have it. In fact, if you're a child of God, and when you are a child of God, you do have it, and you make the choice to let patience work. And when you're looking at somebody that they are operating in the fruit of the Spirit, you won't be able to tell because they're letting patience work. They've got the love, they've got the joy, they've got the peace, the long-suffering, the gentleness, the goodness. Faith there should be, it should be, it should really be translated faithfulness. In this context, it's not our faith in God, it's someone else's faith in you. Because you have the Christian character where you're faithful. You have integrity. People can take you at your word. They can depend upon you because of the Christian character and the attribute that you keep your word and you're trustworthy and you're dependable. And so this is faithfulness, that people can depend on you. You've given your word and you'll keep your word. And so that's the integrity. That's the faithfulness. It's Christian character, your faithfulness. And then meekness, that's control. Self-control is temperance, but this is also controlled strength. Temperance, self-control, against such there is no law. Now, the works of the flesh have laws to control them. I mean, natural laws, God's laws, natural laws. The Ten Commandments, one of them is thou shalt not kill, but you can look at the natural laws that are on the books, and that's against the law of the land. And if you look, it's murder is one of the works of the flesh. Amen. So the works of the flesh have laws to control them. Thou shalt not, thou shalt not, thou shalt not, thou shalt not. The works of the flesh have laws to control them. But the fruit of the Spirit don't need any laws. There's no law that says, no, you're loving too much now. That's too much love. Thou shalt not love any more than you're already doing. Don't go beyond that. No, that's too much law, a love, a love. That's too much joy. That's against the law to have that much joy. There's no law that controls the fruit of the Spirit. Just go ahead and go with it. Have all the love that you can demonstrate. Joy, peace, long-suffering. Having too much peace is not against the law. People may tease you and wonder what's wrong with you. I just like it when people wonder what's wrong with me when I'm operating peace and they're not. Must be something wrong with Brother Tony. He must not understand. You know, he doesn't understand the severity of the situation because I'm operating in peace and operating in faith and operating in joy. And I'm not all torn apart and fall apart and all upset and in turmoil and wringing my hands with anxiety. What are we going to do? We've got to retaliate. We've got to get busy. We've got to do something. We 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 got to do something. Something's wrong with Brother Tony. Well, you get so upset, there's a law that's going to try to control you. Don't you go off doing what you're thinking about doing. Vengeance is mine, I'll repay. Give place unto wrath. I think about some things that Paul wrote to the Romans. In Romans chapter 6, and then we might look at chapter 7 and chapter 8, and here are some things that we did not say. Well, before we go there, and Susan may put this up, but I'll also mention it. The fruit of the Spirit, Galatians 5. It says the fruit of the Spirit, and many people read that as the fruit of the Holy Spirit, and certainly the source is the Holy Spirit. But as it says in John chapter 15, see, there's more than one place that talks about fruit. John 15, Jesus said, I'm the vine, you're the branches, and the fruit grows on branches. Well, if fruit grows on branches, and I'm the branch, then that means I'm the one bearing the fruit. So this is the fruit that is developing and being produced, that's being seen and manifested as I yield. Now, the vine, it's where the sap flows. Jesus said, I'm the vine. So he's the source. He's the life. He's our life. The Spirit of God is the source. The love and the joy and the peace all comes from him. But the fruit is born on the branches, not the vine. So though it's the fruit of the Holy Spirit, it's also the fruit of the human spirit. See, both are true. But people need to see that both are true. It is the fruit of the Holy Spirit, but it's the fruit of the human spirit because you're the one bearing the fruit. The branch bears the fruit. John 15, Jesus said, I'm the vine, you're the branches. And he talked about fruit, and he talked about bringing forth excellent fruit. And he said, if you don't do it, then we're going to take care of that. There's going to be some pruning going on. And that's not always fun. It might hurt a little bit to have some of those things cut off and pruned, but it's for our benefit. Can somebody say amen? Well, it says we yield. Well, in Romans chapter 6, Paul talked about yielding. He's saying some of the same things. In Romans chapter 6, in verse 11, he said, likewise, reckon or consider ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God. I'm going to talk about that in a moment. Alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body. Now you could, or he wouldn't need to say, don't let it. No reason for him to say, don't let it reign, unless it's true you could let it reign. Neither yield ye your members. That's your flesh. So he's talking about yielding. I'd rather yield to God. Don't yield to the flesh and the desires of the flesh as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members, that's your flesh, as instruments of righteousness unto God. See, the spirit and the body, before you're born again, the spirit and the body are tuned to the same spiritual death. Very often when death is mentioned in the Bible, it's not referring to physical death at all. It's referring to spiritual death. And before you're born again, your spirit and your body go in the same direction. They're tuned to the same frequency. But when you're born again, your spirit changes frequency. And now it's tuned to God, and it's no longer tuned to sin. The flesh is still tuned to sin, but your spirit has changed frequency, and now you're not tuned to your own flesh. You're tuned to God. Your flesh is tuned to sin, but you don't have to yield. Don't change the channel. Don't let the flesh get its way. So it says, when it says alive and dead, it really is meaning you're not walking the same walk anymore. You're not in sync anymore. You're not tuned to the same station anymore. And so sin is not going to have dominion over you because you're not under the law, you're under grace. What then? Shall we sin because we're not under the law, but under grace? God forbid. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourself servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obeyed, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness? But God be thanked that ye were the servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered you. Being then made free from sin, you became the servants of righteousness. That is, you've tuned the receiver to a different station, or you've made a different walk. You're going a different direction. Your spirit and your flesh aren't going the same direction anymore. And so they used to, but now they're not. So you're free from sin, and now you're hooked up as a servant of righteousness. Well, come over into chapter 7 and verse 7. The whole chapter is wonderful. What shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid. Nay, I had not known sin but by the law. I had not known lust except the law said, thou shalt not covet. But sin, taking occasion by the commandment, wrought in me all manner of concupiscence. For without the law, sin was dead. That is, I didn't know I was sinning until somebody told me. I didn't know I was sinning until the law came. Sometimes we talk about the age of accountability, where the person realizes the difference between right and wrong. And then when the law of Moses came, that was very clear. This is wrong in the eyes of God. Well, they didn't know what was wrong till they heard that. And so sin without the law is without the law. Sin is dead. Verse 9, I was alive without the law, but when the commandment came, sin revived and I died. The commandment was ordained to life, but I found it to be death because it told me that I was sinning. And when I found that out, that worked death in me. Verse 12, the law is holy. The commandment holy and just and good. Was then that which is good made death unto me? God forbid. But sin, that it might appear sin, working death in me by that which is good, and sin by the commandment might become exceeding sinful. For I know that the law is spiritual, but I'm carnal, sold under sin. For that which I do, I allow not. For that, for what I would, that do I not. For what I hate, that do I. I've heard preachers say, that's me. I've heard preachers from the pulpit read this verse and say, that's me. I do what I hate and I don't do what I wish I would do. He said, I heard a preacher one time, I'm thinking of right now. He said, I'm just like Paul. I do the thing that I hate and I end up not doing what I know I should. I'm just like Paul. And I'm sitting there in the congregation. I wanted to say it out loud. He's talking about before he was saved. He's talking about before he was saved. Because you keep on reading, you'll find out how he talked after he got saved. Before he got saved, he knew the law. Now, it's just holy and good, but what it did for him, it worked death. Sin appeared exceeding sinful and worked death. And he found out that what he didn't want to do, he ended up doing, and what he wanted to do, he didn't do. Verse 16, then I do that which I would not, and I consent unto the law that is good. It's no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. Verse 19 now. The good that I would, I do not. The evil which I would not, that I do. That preacher said, I'm just like Paul. That's me. And I wanted to shout. That's before he was saved. Verse 22, I delight in the law after God, after the inward man, but I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? And in that day, I understand that there was a book or a writing, a tome, T-O-M-E, tome, that was well known. There was an author that was well known that referred to capital punishment, that they would sentence someone to death by strapping an indigent body, dead body, to his back. And that dead body would decay and eat away the flesh of the living body, and that was his punishment unto death. And that was a popular writing and colloquial, and people knew about it. That sentence unto death, a capital punishment, that he sentenced to die, and the body of an indigent one that had died would be strapped to his back and have a slow, painful death, because the decaying flesh would putrefy and contaminate and kill his flesh while he's alive, and he would die. And Paul is saying, sin is strapped to my flesh, and I'm dead. And it's causing me to appear. It's working death. It's working death. A sin is appearing exceeding sinful. Working death. Working. Who's going to deliver me from this body of death? This sin that's strapped to my back, that's working death in me. Who's going to deliver me? Who's going to deliver me from this body of death? Who's going to deliver me from this body of death? What I want to do, I don't do. And what I don't want to do, I do do. Oh, wretched man that I am. And that preacher said, that's just like me. I'm just like Paul. And I wanted to shout out, that's before he was saved. Who's going to deliver me from this body? The body of this death. I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, with the mind I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh the law of sin. Now verse 1. Of chapter 8. There is therefore now, everybody say now. See, chapter 8 is after he got saved. Chapter 7 is before he got saved. Chapter 7 is when he knew the law, but he couldn't keep it. And what did that law do? It caused sin to appear exceeding sinful, and it worked death. So to Paul, who was then called Saul before he was saved, the law of Moses to him was a law of sin and death, because it made sin appear exceeding sinful and it worked death. So he called the law of Moses, though it's holy, just, and good, he called it the law of sin and death, because it caused sin to appear exceeding sinful and it worked death. So the law of Moses is the law of sin and death. And I thank God, Jesus Christ has delivered me. There's therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. The law that caused sin to appear exceeding sinful, Jesus Christ has made me free from that. The law that worked death in me, it's just holy and good, but I couldn't keep it. It's just holy and good, but I couldn't keep it. I wanted to, but I couldn't keep it. Who's going to deliver me from the body of this death? I thank God through Jesus Christ. Now, there's no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Because the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. The law, what law? The law of sin and death. What law? The law of Moses. It couldn't do it. It couldn't bring righteousness to me. It was weak through the flesh. But God, sending His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us. Everybody say, in us. Who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Verse 8, they that are in the flesh cannot please God. Verse 8, they that are in the flesh cannot please God. When you yield to the flesh, you can't please God. But you're not in the flesh. That means you're not yielding to it if you're walking in the Spirit. You're tuned to a different frequency now. You're walking a different walk. You're going a different direction. If the Spirit of God dwell in you. And if you don't have the Spirit of Christ, you're none of His. If Christ is in you, the body is dead. Now, we ought to know what that means. Because people say, well, I'm dead to sin. Well, your body's dead too. If you don't know what the one means, you won't know what the other means. Because how many of you, go ahead and pinch yourself. See if your body's dead. If you pinch yourself, will it hurt? She didn't pinch herself. She pinched her neighbor. He's not talking about the physical body and the physical life and the physical death and the physical realm. He's talking about the body is dead to the Spirit, just like the Spirit is dead to the flesh. And the flesh has the nature of sin, but your spirit, born again by the Holy Spirit, if you'll walk in the Spirit, you're dead to sin and you're dead to the flesh, and your body is dead to you. Your body is dead to the Spirit. Your body is dead to righteousness. Your body is dead to God, and you're dead to your body. Your body's dead to you, and your body's dead to God. You're alive to God, you're dead to your body. You're walking a different walk. You're going a different direction. You're tuned to a different frequency. And if you would yield your members to the Spirit, you wouldn't. Paul said it this way to the Galatians in chapter 5, if you walk in the Spirit, you don't fulfill the lust of the flesh. He's saying the same thing. If I walk in the Spirit, I'll yield my members not to unrighteousness, but to righteousness. Because my body's dead. I'm dead to my body. I don't have to obey my body anymore. I don't have to obey the flesh anymore. And though the law is just and holy and good, I'm not obeying the letter of the law. I'm obeying the Spirit of God, which is in line. I mean, it's still God's will. The Ten Commandments are still God's will, but I don't obey them because they're the Ten Commandments. I obey them because the Spirit of God is on the inside of me. He shows me how to love. Love is the fulfilling of the law. That's what Paul wrote in Romans 13. When you walk in love, you don't commit adultery. When you walk in love, you don't covet. When you walk in love, you don't bear false witness. When you walk in love, you don't steal. When you walk in love, you don't kill. When you walk in love, because love is the fulfilling of the law. And Jesus said, I'm giving you a new commandment. And John said in 1 John 3, this is His commandment, that we believe on the name of His Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as He gave commandment. How do we love? As He gave commandment. How do we love? As He gave commandment. That is, love as I've loved. I need to think about how He would treat people before I go treating them a certain way. I need to think about how he would treat the people before I go treating them a certain way. I need to think about how he would talk about those people before I go talking about them a certain way. I need to think about how he would respond to those people before I go to respond in a certain way. Because I'm to love the way he loved and loves the fulfilling of the law. And if I walk in the Spirit, I won't fulfill the lust of the flesh. My body's dead to the nature of righteousness. And if I will walk in the Spirit, I'm dead to my body. So I'm to yield. Again, Romans chapter 6. I mean, it's a theme. What I'm going to choose to do. What I'm going to yield myself unto. I choose to walk in love. I choose to have joy. I choose to maintain my peace. I choose to walk in the fruit. Love, joy, peace. Long-suffering, that's patience. Gentleness, goodness, faithfulness, meekness, temperance. It's a choice. It's what I yield my members unto. It's how I'm walking. So when they hit my one cheek, now I've got a choice. Do I retaliate in the flesh in my anger, or do I retaliate the way the Spirit of God would lead me? And the strength of God, the ability of God, the control, the self-control, those are spiritual forces. Amen. Give place unto wrath. Vengeance is mine, I will repay. If your enemy's hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him drink. Heap coals of fire upon his head. Don't let that overcome you. You overcome it. How are you going to do it? With good Christian character.